Our newest Joggles product may seem somewhat familiar to those of you who've watched our videos for a while. We previously offered a 6x6 chipboard tunnel book that was bound with book rings. Today's video is all about this new watercolor version that features the same graduated round openings in the pages and is disc bound. I'll demo how to create the background on the pages and talk about the kit that includes the tunnel book plus the collage sheets to create what you see here. This is really quite a simple project. At its most basic, you have to add color and texture to the page backgrounds and let them dry, then cut out and arrange the collage elements and the butterfly quotes. That's really it. Now, admittedly, the cutting out can take a little bit of time, and you can do that one of two ways. You can kind of cut them all out at once so that you have them all to play with, or you can debut them and kind of cut them on demand, which is more or less what I did. So the first thing that you have to do are the page backgrounds. Within the frame of how much space I have to work here, I couldn't do all 8 pages at once, but my table is certainly big enough to do that. Now, if you don't have a table big enough to assembly line them, it's not the end of the world. I just find that it's quicker to do them that way. The one thing that I will tell you that you should try to do, we're using Marabu's Graphix Aqua ink. This is black, so this is their liquid watercolor, and you do want to shake it vigorously before you use it. But the way to ensure some consistency in the look and the feel of these pages is to mix enough of the aqua ink with water to begin with so that you're working with the same density of water and watercolor, so that whatever you're doing, it's consistent across all of those pages. That way the dilution is the same. Now, again, it's not the end of the world. If you have to mix another batch, you can always do that, but I try to do enough in the beginning so that I don't have to. So the process is pretty straightforward, and you can see that I've done obviously both sides here. What I'm going to do is I have a couple of just page backgrounds. These are our basic 6x6 watercolor disc bound journal pages. If you have these pages at home from a journal, then you actually already have extra front and back covers if you need them. So the kit is going to include front and back cover, and then each of the 6 sized openings that are available. So it starts with 4.5 and goes all the way down to 2. So the kit will include that, plus it will include the 4 collage sheets that you'll eventually see as we go along. So I'm gonna pull these back toward me a little bit, and I'm gonna mix my aqua ink and water up here. I'm gonna put some water out. Now, I'm not mixing enough for the front and back of 8 pages, or even if you just do the front of 8 and then mix again for the back of 8. I don't need to mix quite that much. I just don't, because I'm not gonna do that much. So I'm going to go ahead and shake up my aqua ink. And this is just plain old black. There are lots of colors in the aqua ink line. I chose to go with black. I've kept this really very simple. You could add a little tiny bit of pink if you want. You could use brown, or you could use a combination of the dark brown and the black. This just happens to be what I went with. So I'm going to put some color out there, and you can see that it's starting to lighten. Is kind of a funny word to use with black, but it's starting to lighten because I've thinned the color out. And I think I probably want to thin that a little bit more. If I think that it's too thin, I can always add a little bit more as I go along. I don't think I'm going to need to, though. So with that ready, and this is just a filbert brush, any kind of a brush that you have that's big enough so that you can hold enough liquid in here will be good. When I spatter, I'm going to switch to something smaller, but that's a second down the road here. So the next thing I want to do is wet these pages. Now, how much water is on these pages is going to influence how much the color wicks when you put it on there. I went with not super heavy amounts here. I'm just trying to keep it reasonably consistent so that what I got was kind of bursts that wicked a little bit, and you'll see what that means. So all I'm going to do is just that. Now you can see that I'm getting more wicking here and less here. Well, that's easy enough to fix, and I'll show you how to do that in 1 second. All right, so obviously there's not nearly as much wicking going on here, and if I want the color to be a little bit more dense, I can add some more. The way to make this start to wick is to apply some more water so that it spreads out. And that's it. This is really all that doing the backgrounds is about, other than the patience to let it dry or to get in there with a heat tool and dry it a little bit more. Now, if you think the color is a little bit too dense, you can certainly remedy that by coming in and just tapping some with paper towel if you want. And there's all kinds of ways to experiment here, so don't be shy about how you do that. So for the sake of argument, we're going to pretend that these are done. And I like this look where it kind of forms little bits of patterns. If I bring one of these larger pages back in, you can see that that's what I've got going on here. There's definitely patterns in places, and it's softer and more spread out in others. That happened to be the look that I was trying to achieve. Let me slide these out of the way for 1 second. I'm not going to take the time to dry them. I'm just going to grab something else, and I'm going to show you what I do to spatter. Now you can choose to do one of two things. You can, three things really. You can spatter with the same color that you used, or the same mixture of water and black aqua ink that you used for your page backgrounds. You can put a little bit more of the black in it if you want them to be a little bit darker, or you can go with black directly out of the bottom. Again, it's entirely up to you. What I do want to show you though is the difference between, let me just grab another page here. Well, let me grab one of these pages since it's all I have handy. I want to show you the difference between what happens when you spatter on something dry versus when something is wet. So I'm just going to lay some water over here, excuse me, some paper towel over here, and I'm going to wet this side. This side is for the most part dry. I'm going to take just a little bit more of the aqua ink and I'm going to dip my brush in here. I want the, on mine, I made the dots a little bit darker, so that meant I came back and added a little bit more of the black. What I'm going to do is just wet my brush. Now here's the way that spattering works. I like to use a brush that's, this is a number 8 round. I don't want to go with anything that's too much bigger because then there's going to be more liquid in it. So the way that spatters work is the more liquid that's in the brush, the bigger your dots that are probably going to be. So conversely, if there's less in here, and I'm going to tap some of it off because I'm going to go for smaller dots, then you'll see that you're going to get smaller dots. So again, pretty little dots if I just do that. Now if I come back and I add some more liquid, you can see automatically what happens with bigger dots. They just, it's just a part and parcel of how much liquid is in that brush. Now if I come over here and I spatter where things are wet is when I get that wicking and bleeding. So if you want discrete dots, and if you want tiny discrete dots, you're going to put less liquid on your paintbrush and you're going to make certain that your surface is completely dry. If you want bigger dots, you'll use a little bit more liquid. I would experiment on another piece of paper so that you get the hang of doing this, and then you'll also get the hang of how much water versus, the size of the spots and how dark you want your mixture to be. As I said, on mine, I mixed the spatter color just a little bit darker so that the dots wouldn't get too lost in what was already there. So once the pages are dry, it's time to start thinking about how to lay out the elements. So let me clean up this mess and I'll come back and we'll talk about that next. These are the two pages that I put the background on just a few moments ago, and as you can see, this one side is completely dry. Actually, both sides are dry. I just haven't done anything on the back yet. What I want you to notice is that these are kind of warped. This is watercolor paper. It's Strathmore 140-pound cold-pressed watercolor paper, but enough water on any paper, even really good watercolor paper, is going to leave you with some warping after the fact. Now, if I bring in the cover from my book, you'll notice that it is quite a bit flatter. Honestly, the way to fix this is to stack them up maybe 3 or 4 at a time and press them with a hot iron. Now put another piece of paper over the top, press them on one side, flip them, then press them on the other side, and eventually you'll find out, or you'll find yourself with pages that are flatter, more like this. Now I do this before I glue all the elements on, so I'm working with a reasonably flat surface to begin with. So I want to talk about the 4 collage sheets that come in the kit. This is my cover. Let me pull that out for one second. Let me turn this so it's oriented toward you. So the first sheet in the kit includes all of the moths that you see here. Now I'm probably going to refer to them as butterflies, and the quotes are technically butterfly quotes. I get that these aren't butterflies, but it's the closest. I don't think there are a lot of quotes about moths, so we just went with the butterflies. You'll notice that there are 6 different styles, and each is available in more than one size. I did that deliberately so you'd have enough to work with on the pages like this, where there's not a lot to work on, versus the pages like this, or the covers, like this, or the covers, where you have much bigger areas. You'll also notice that each of the butterflies has a mirror image directly opposite on the sheet, and that's going to be important in a second, and I'll show you why that's going to be important. So this is sheet 1, this is the 2nd sheet, this is the wreath that's on my front cover, and it has these botanicals. This is the 3rd sheet. It's got 2 full wreaths on it that I haven't even begun to use yet, some botanicals, and again, some more of the moths, with each with a mirror image. And then the last sheet are the butterfly quotes. Now you can write them by hand too if you want, and I'll show you how I did that also. When I cut the wreaths out, and let's come back to my cover. When I cut the wreaths out, you'll notice that I'm not right down cutting away every last bit of the background. If I hold this up, maybe you can see it a little bit better. I don't have the time, and quite honestly, I don't have the patience for that. I don't mind the white border here. I don't think that it looks bad at all. If you want to be a little bit more precise about how you cut, then of course you can do that. Now, I do fussy cut when I get to the moths, or when I get to the botanicals like I did here. I don't necessarily want to see so much border there, primarily because these are standalone elements and I don't want them to get lost anywhere. I want them to be very visual and very easy to see. So when I did my book, I did this cover first because I kind of felt like it set the entire tone for the book. I had a sense of direction at that point and I knew where I was going to go. So the next thing that I did was this page here, and you can see that this moth extends into the tunnel area, and this is going to be why the mirror images are important. If you look at the page from this side, you see a moth. If I turn this over, you see the backside of the moth, and I've done that quite deliberately. Now, I could have left it white, and you could have backed it with something or just left it white if you wanted to, but I feel like doing this gives it a little bit more of a finished and polished look. So let me show you how easy this is. I'm not going to glue these in place, but let's say for the sake of argument that I wanted this to extend into the tunnel more or less like that. If I hold these two pieces up front to front, you can see that they don't match. But if I hold them back to back, or sorry, back to front, if I hold them back to back, you'll see that they match up almost exactly now, allowing some variance for me not cutting exactly the same every single time. But you can see what happens. If I were to glue these on this sheet like this, again, or on this page like this, again, when I turn this over, I'm going to have the back of the moth in place where it needs to be. So what I generally do is lay the moth on the page first and glue that part down, and then once I'm satisfied, I'll actually come over here, and then I'll put glue on the back of this, and I will go ahead and align it, and then once I've got it on the piece that protrudes into the tunnel, I'll come back and I'll do the rest of it under here. Actually, very simple. The premise is very simple. It's just cut, align, and go ahead and glue them in place. So if you get one that doesn't match exactly, let's come back to the one that's already done. I can tell you for a fact that these did not match perfectly. I came in with some really tiny scissors and I just trimmed until it did, because again, there's no chance that I'm going to cut those identically each time. Now the other thing that I want you to notice is that there's some scribbling in here. This is, I did with a black super fine PITT pen. It's the one with the S on the top. You could also use the XS, which is the extra super fine. So I did the writing around here. In addition to the quotes, you can see that there's just little stitch marks along the edge here. And then here I just drew some kind of scallop shapes, and I took a moment and I just picked some of the spattered dots and I put circles around them. You can be as elaborate or as simple as you want with all of this kind of stuff. You can put way more stuff on your pages than I have. I tend to be very much of a minimalist when I do these kinds of things, but there are people who are great at combining lots of different elements, so you get something that is quite a bit busier, but it doesn't look busy for the sake of being busy. It just looks really good. So the last thing that I'm going to show you is how I developed the layout for the inside back cover. Again, pretty straightforward. There's not a lot of rocket science to any of this. I knew that when I opened the front cover, I wanted to look down the openings of the tunnel until I got to the smallest one, and I knew I wanted to see a moth in there to some extent. I don't want it centered because I think that looks a little bit too planned, but my goal is to have it kind of something like this. Now, the way to figure out how to do that is you've got to actually have your back cover in place. Let's take this out of here for the sake of argument. This is the page with the 2-inch opening, so it's the smallest one. For a little bit of perspective, I like to kind of put the top ones on as well so you can see where this is going. This is the page with the biggest opening. I haven't really done anything to it yet. This is the one you saw a moment ago that has some things done on it already. And what I like is when these are stacked up, I can see the text. Now, I probably won't put text around all of the openings. I think that that would just be a little bit too busy, but I'll figure that out as I go along. So what I like to do is imagine myself looking down the tunnel to this spot right here, and then I know that I want to use this moth, and I know I want it to look maybe something a little bit like that. So with that in mind, I can just kind of hold this in place and then go ahead and put the moth in. Now, before I actually glue it down, and I'm not quite ready to do that, and this ends up being a play with it, adjust it, play with it, and then finally get it in place kind of deal, I knew that I wanted to do some writing around here. Now, I don't want to do it around that last opening because it's only 2 inches in diameter and it makes a pretty tight circle to write around. So what I did was I took the page that is two smaller than that. So it would go, technically it would go like this. It would go the 2-inch opening like this, the 2.5 inch opening, and then this is the one with the 3 inch opening. So what I did, and we're going to ignore this for 1 second, what I did was imagine that my moth would be in there kind of like this. And since I want some writing, what I'm going to do is remove these two pages, and then if you lift up and I lay this down, you can see I came in with my handy dandy pencil and I traced around that. So if I hold this up, you can see that there's a pencil mark on here. So this is going to be my guide for writing around. I'm going to do that right now with that same super fine PITT pen. Now, there are plenty of quotes on here. I'm just going to start one. I'm not going to get all the way around, and I'm just going to choose this one that says, "Love is like a butterfly. It settles upon you when you least expect it." I think I can get that in here. If I think that I wanted to adjust the size of the characters or whatever to make it fit or not, then I can do that, or else I could choose something that was a different size. But for the sake of argument, I'm just going to start with that. Now, I do want to show you. See, there's some scallops penciled in here. I kind of thought about mimicking this look, but then I decided against it. I decided that really wasn't what I want to do. So when I do this, this is how the page is going to be oriented. Honestly, it doesn't really matter where you begin the quote. I'm just going to begin it here. Okay, so I have a little bit of gap here. Will you know? Is anybody going to read this? I'm just going to put some stuff that looks like text in there to fill it up. And honestly, that's good enough for me. So then the challenge becomes, not the challenge, but the next step becomes putting this back. Now, in terms of erasing these pencil marks, PITT pens dry really fast. They are mostly impervious to water. I hesitate to use the word permanent because that suggests a level of permanence that sometimes can be hard to achieve. I'll come in with a regular eraser and I will erase all the pencil marks, but you got to make certain that you give this plenty of time to dry, because if you smudge it, there is no going back. You can camouflage it, but you're not going to fix those smudges, so I'll probably make that the very last thing I do. So okay, here is my page with the smallest opening. I know I want my moth to look something like that, so I'm just going to call that done. I'm going to hold this with my finger, she said, get rid of that page. And now what I'm going to do, this is Scotch Quick Dry Adhesive. This is a 2 ounce bottle. And let me talk to you a little bit before I start gluing. Let me talk to you a little bit about this fine line applicator. This is, as I said, a 2 ounce bottle. When you look at, there's no industry standard, but there's kind of what most people do. When you look at the neck opening on this bottle, it measures 2 inches in diameter. Whoops, help if the glare wasn't on there. So this fine line applicator is designated as a 20/410. 20 simply means that it fits a bottle with a half inch neck opening. 410 has something to do with the configuration of the threads. That is actually pretty standard, so that fits on here. Now, perversely, when you talk about the gauge of the needle opening, you would think that the bigger the number, the bigger the opening, but nope, that's not the way it works. So this is, I believe, an 18 gauge. For something like liquid glue, the minimum size you should use, the minimum tip gauge size is 18. If you have hands that are cranky and are getting a little bit older and maybe you don't have the hand strength you used to, I would suggest using a 15 or 16 gauge, but remember, it's the 20/410 tip that you need, or applicator unit that you need, that will fit on this bottle that has the half inch neck opening. All right, so having talked about that, let me bring this back and make certain that this is about where I want it. All right, that looks pretty good. So rather than trying to pick this up and place it, and this is where this applicator comes in really handy. Now, this bottle is kind of empty, so I have to wait for the product. There it goes. I have to wait for the product to get down there. But you can see that I can get glue exactly where I need it, and then I can just go ahead and tap this in place. And quick dry means just that. It dries really, really fast. Now, the one thing that you do need to do, if you have any that oozes out, you have to be careful that you wipe it up thoroughly, because it will leave a shiny little edge if you don't. So same process. I'm just going to put a little bit of adhesive here, and go ahead and press that in place. And then if there's any that leaks out, I'm going to be careful to wipe it up. Now, some of these moths are so tiny, and with that done, I'm going to put this top back on. It's got the wire that goes inside the applicator. Some of these moths have antennae that are so tiny, I don't even cut them out, I cut them off. For example, if I show you the cover, all of these moths, I drew on the antennas because they're just too tiny to cut out, and really, who has time for that and who needs the aggravation? So now I've got this done. We've already said that I'm not going to erase for a little bit of while because I want to let this all dry. So it's time to think about what else I want to do. And at this point, the answer is I'm not certain. I have all of these collage sheet elements to work from. I could use another moth, butterfly, call it what you want. I could pick a botanical. There's lots of different ways to do that. And really, it's a matter of preference. What do you like and how do you like the way that it looks? So the last thing that I want to talk about is sparkly stuff, because in my world, there always needs to be some. I want to say that this is Ranger Stickles. This is Mercury Glass. You could use mercury glass, you could use platinum, you could use silver. They even make black diamond. All I did was put it so that it kind of gathers around the edges of the cutout elements. I'm trying to make the glitter reflect in the light. It's a little bit hard to do, but you'll notice that there it is. There's some up along here. I didn't spread it out around in the background so much as I just kind of let it gather around those pieces. You can do whatever you want. If you want to put more glitter on, you certainly can. If you want to do more doodling than I did, you certainly can. But I guess what I really like about this is that the sky is the limit. You can make these pages as elaborate as you want. You could come in and add charms. There's just any number of ways that you can create this book and make it your own. I'm really happy with what I've done so far. I'm especially fond of the cover. I don't know if I'm going to put some kind of a quote on here, but at this point, I really, really like this. I had a lot of fun creating my version of the book, and I hope that you have fun creating yours.